Secretary, good morning, everyone. Secretary Galvez, thanks for a very productive meeting, and congratulations again on your new position. I look forward to continuing to work closely together. Now, this was the fourth discussion that I've had with the Department of National Defense leaders since the start of the Marcos administration. And that just underscores the importance that both of our countries place on this relationship. This is our oldest treaty alliance in Southeast Asia. We conduct more than 500 defense engagements together every year. As President Biden has made clear, America's commitment to the defense of the Philippines is ironclad. Our alliance makes both of our democracies more secure and helps uphold a free and open Indo-Pacific. And today, we discussed ways to make this vital alliance even stronger. We talked about enhancing our mutual defense posture and strengthening our commitments under our mutual defense treaty. We discussed expanding the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement, which allows our forces to operate together more efficiently from key sites across the Philippines. We talked about how we are co-investing in EDCA sites to support security cooperation, combined training, humanitarian assistance, and disaster relief. And all those efforts make both of our countries more secure. And we're pleased to announce today that President Marcos has approved four new EDCA locations. And that brings the total number of EDCA sites to 9. And I'm grateful to President Marcos for this decision. Today, Secretary Galvez and I also reaffirmed our mutual defense treaty commitments. And we'd note that the mutual defense treaty applies to armed attacks on either of our armed forces, public vessels, or aircraft anywhere in the South China Sea or the West Philippine Sea. We discussed concrete actions to address destabilizing activities in the waters surrounding the Philippines, including the West Philippine Sea. And we remain committed to strengthening our mutual capacities to resist armed attack. That's just part of our efforts to modernize our alliance. And these efforts are especially important as the People's Republic of China continues to advance its illegitimate claims in the West Philippine Sea. Now, I'm proud of the work that we've done together. I am optimistic about the future of our alliance, and I am confident that we will continue to work together to defend our shared values of freedom, democracy, and human dignity. As you've heard me say before, the United States and the Philippines are more than just allies. We're family. So once again, Mr. Secretary, thanks for your hospitality, and thanks to everyone. We'll be glad to take a few questions.
All right, our first question will go to Karen DeYoung with the Washington Post.
Thank you, Secretaries. This is a question to both of you. I wonder if you could tell us the location of the new access sites and specifically how they position each of your forces better to hopefully deter and possibly confront Chinese aggression in the South China Sea and beyond in the region, and to address Philippines-specific concerns. And more generally, it's no secret that relations between our two governments were strained under the previous Philippines administration. I wonder if you could give us your assessment of the relationship now and moving forward. Thank you.
We'll start with the end of that, Karen, and my assessment, and I share this assessment with many of the with the leadership in our government, is that this relationship is strong, and we will continue to work hard to strengthen it further. In terms of the EDCA locations. I just want to be clear that we're not seeking permanent basing in the Philippines. As you heard us say in our statements here, EDCA is a cooperative agreement that enables rotational activities. And so it's a key pillar of training and opportunities for to strengthen our interoperability. And it also provides us the ability to respond effectively to humanitarian issues and also disaster relief and other types of crises, not just for the Philippines, but for the region throughout. And I'll turn it over to my colleague here, Secretary Galvez.
Yes, we have agreed that the statement of the sites will be concluded once we have already made collaboration also with the local communities. Because when we when we make announcements, we need to local government, the governors, and also the local populace to be consulted. And the president wanted that all of our actions should be consulted with our local governments, and we wanted also to see that these disagreements of the four EDCA sites will be finished soon, considering that we are also making some inspections on how we will do things, particularly that these areas identified are very vulnerable to climate change. And we have seen during the typhoon Ondoy and Ramil that our ally, U.S., have deployed 4 C-130s and also the Seahawks there when the areas were being isolated. So what we want is really to tell you that we will finish the identification soonest. And we are committed to a strong alliance. The president have said that our alliance now is more stronger and robust, as he said it this morning. And we are very confident that working with Secretary Anyo and with the AAP, we are looking forward that we will have a high drive of some activities with our allies. And I would like to thank this opportunity that the visit of Secretary Lloyd Austin is very, very meaningful to us. This is symbolic to all of us that the U.S. Will always be there for us.
The next question will come from Chino Gaston of GMA7.
Good afternoon, secretaries. The U.S. being the biggest or one of the biggest players in the West Philippine Sea, may we have your insight on the what people look at as more assertive activity of the Philippines and the West Philippine Sea in response to Chinese incursions within our EEZ, like the Philippine ships shadowing the Chinese ships, which the U.S., we understand, routinely does. And your take also, Mr. Secretary, on the code of conduct. Does that help, you think? What's the U.S. take on the code of conduct, which many see as merely China's attempt to have a claim of legitimacy if it's included between the code of conduct between ASEAN and China? Thank you, sir.
So we will continue to work with our allies and partners in the region who are like-minded and who value a free and open Indo-Pacific. And you've heard both of us talk about that today. That's real important. You've also heard us talk about the rules-based international order and maintaining that. So, the ability of nations to sail the seas and operate in international waters and operate in the international skies, I think is really important. And we would look for countries to respect a rules-based international order. So that's our focus, and it's been our focus in the past, and it will remain our focus going forward. So.
All right, our next question will go to Jeff Selden from VOA.
Secretary Galvez, U.S. officials have said one of the aims of these talks has been to help the Philippines with military modernization. and was wondering what type of military modernization help is the Philippines looking for, training, equipment, and if equipment, what sort of equipment, weapons and systems, does the Philippines military need to take on both the threats from terrorism and the growing concerns in the region, especially the aggressiveness from China? And Secretary Austin, what is the U.S. looking to provide and when? And as part of the new EDCA agreement, how many more U.S. troops will be stationed in the Philippines in addition to the 500 that are already here? And if I may, Secretary Austin, following the decision to provide Ukraine with more tanks, Kyiv has been asking for more F-16s. A number of European allies have said that they think it's a good idea. Given that, is providing F-16s to Ukraine something that you're willing to reconsider?
Thanks, Jeff. So on the first piece, as I said earlier, EDCA is not about permanent basing here in the Philippines. It's about providing access that allows us to increase our training opportunities with our partners, our allies here. It's about having the ability to respond in a more effective fashion as we're collectively faced with humanitarian assistance issues or natural or disaster response issues, and so this is an opportunity to increase our effectiveness, increase interoperability. It is not about permanent basing, but it is a big deal. It's a really big deal in that it gives us. Provides us the opportunity again to interact a bit more in an effective way. Regarding F-16s, I think was your second question, right? You know, Jeff, we're focused on providing Ukraine the capability that it needs to be effective in its upcoming anticipated counteroffensive in the spring. And so we're doing everything we can to get them the capabilities that they need right now to be effective on the battlefield. You heard us talk about artillery, air defense. We made a big push to provide more armored vehicle capability, and so all of those things are in play. And we're also increasing the training that we're providing the Ukrainians so that these higher-end platforms they can effectively use in combat. So that's our focus currently. And I think, as we bring this together in support of the Ukrainians, it's going to provide a significant capability.
Yeah, on your question that what are the things that we need in order to increase our capability, I believe it's more on the heavy lift and medium lift capability, like what we have bought before for our disaster relief and search and rescue operations, because as you all know, with the shear line effect of much raining, we really need C-130s and also the Black Hawk that we bought, that we got reconfigured to SAR, search and rescue capability. And also in our capability to defend our maritime domain. And I believe one of the requests of the Chief of Staff is really on how to detect even the coastal and the submarine capability down there in the West Philippine Sea. And we also look at the capability training as Secretary Lloyd Austin that we will modernize our alliance. And I believe with the first class training that we will be getting from the U.S. Forces, and we will try to expand it, I believe we will have a strong army and strong armed forces. As we have shared the same experience when we were in West Mekong, the Special Operation Task Force that has stayed there since 2000, there is a rotational deployments of areas like in Basilan and also Sulu in the early days. These deployments are very useful to us and very encouraging, considering that we were able to eradicate terrorism in the areas of Sulu, Basilan. And now, as we have boasted, Sulu now has a nightlife. Sulu before, you cannot see any people during 12 4 o'clock in the afternoon. They are all in their houses. Now we have a freedom of movement. And I think Secretary Austin is very much amazed that more than hundreds of Abu Sayyaf and terrorists and jihadists had already been surrendered. And they are now living a peaceful life. And I believe the tremendous help of the U.S., particularly also in the Battle of Marawi, which I've been involved with, I would like to really say that this is my time to thank the U.S. government for helping us and not leaving us in those fight. And the capability that they have brought to us, the Eye in the Sky, the Sky Eagle, and also the C-130 that are roaming around Marawi 24/7, that capability is very, very also useful to patrol our territory. And that's what I think what we need. The joint training and the joint experience that we had has been very, very robust. And we have seen the success of our counterterrorism effort down south.
The last question will come from Karen Lema of Reuters.
Hello, Secretary Austin. Hello, Secretary Galvez. I know you were already asked about the EDCA sites, but if I could press on that question, if you could at least confirm whether these bases will be located in the northern part of Luzon that is close to Taiwan and in Palawan, which is close to Spratlys, and what role will these sites play in the event of a conflict over Taiwan? And Secretary Austin, if I may ask you, because the North Korean Foreign Ministry issued a statement today after the U.S.-South Korea drills. They said that the United States have pushed the situation to an extreme red line and threatened to turn the peninsula into a huge war arsenal and a more critical war zone. Thank you.
As I've said earlier, we will help with the announcement of the EDCA sites because our protocols and also our diplomatic notes have not been completed. So we need to complete all the staff work, including our consultation with the LGUs. So pardon me, I cannot really say where the EDCA sites are located. Please, also we want also to respect the consultations with our LGUs and also with Secretary Benhur Avalos.
Sir, I'm sorry, but when you say four locations, it's four bases. Because I think there was an earlier announcement.
I think we have to remove the word basis because we called it EDSA sites.
Okay, sites, yes. Secretary.
So your question was my reaction to the statement released by North Korea?
Yes.
I would simply say that, our goal is and always has been to promote greater security and stability throughout the region. We remain committed to our extended deterrence commitment, and we're very serious about that when it comes to the ROK. And we will continue to work alongside our allies and train and ensure that we maintain credible and ready forces. So I'll stop there.
Thank you, Secretary. Appreciate it.
That concludes our press conference. I'd like to thank Secretary Austin and Secretary Galvez for their time, as well as my co-moderator, Mr. Mager, for helping me out, I think.